students, now we'll go for the topic photodetectors. So under photodetectors, in the previous video we had seen about the photodiode operation. Now we'll go for avalanche photodiode. So here in your photodiode with an internal gain, so here in this case the internal gain that is going to be available in the photodiode is going to be mainly the primary signal current is going to be multiplied internally, and it is before it is going to enter into the circuitry of your amplifier there. So you know that a photodetector is going to be connected to your amplifier circuitry there. So in that case, I have to increase the gain of the photocurrent. So to increase the gain of the photocurrent, we are going to multiply the primary signal photocurrent before it is going to enter the input circuitry of your amplifier there. And next is we have to increase the receiver sensitivity there. So receiver sensitivity is, again here in this case, my amplifier circuitry should be able to detect even a weak signal there. And in that case, what this photodiode has to do is, it has to multiply the photocurrent even before the encountering the thermal noise. That is, in the receiver circuit we'll be having a thermal noise before reaching the before the thermal noise is going to be imposed onto this photocurrent. This photocurrent should be multiplied. That means that my photodiode should have a higher sensitivity, and as well as it should have a high gain there. So for carrier multiplication, the photo generated carriers must traverse a region where a high electric field is going to be present. So suppose in the high field region, when a photo generated electron or hole is going to gain enough energy so that it is going to ionize a bond that is going to be available in the valence band, upon colliding with them, then that type of ionization is going to be called as impact ionization. That is, in the high field region, when a photo generated electron or hole is going to gain enough energy and it is going to ionize the bonds that is going to be present in the valence band. So when it ionizes a bond, an electron will be released from the covalent bond, and this in turn will go collide with the another bond that is going to be connected to another atom there. So in that case, we are going to have the factor called your impact ionization process. So you know that when an electron is going to hit with a high energy, is going to collide with an atom, that is with an atom present in the with an electron present in the valence band, it is going to release this electron, and it is going to convert the electrons are going this electron is going to be released from the covalent bond there. So here in this, ionization is going to be called as your impact ionization. So here the newly created carriers are also going to be accelerated by the high electric field, and this is going to gain enough energy to go and release some more electrons from the neighboring bonds there. So in that case, we are going to have an avalanche effect. So when one electron goes and hits the another electron, then in that case that electron will get freed up from the covalent bond, and we will be having two electrons. These two electrons will again gain enough energy and go and collide with the neighboring atoms there, where in turn it is going to release two more electrons there. So from then it is going to release the electrons from the two covalent bonds present in the other atoms there. So in that case, we have 4 electrons there. So this 4 will be multiplied as 8 and 8 by 16. So this process is going to be done by the impact ionization, and this effect is going to be called as the avalanche effect. So here in your photodiode structure, we are going to have the P+ type material, your intrinsic layer, and we are going to have your P material and your N+ region there. So here between the P and N+, we are going to have the depletion region to be present, where this is going to be the width of the field. Then in that case, this is going to have the avalanche region there. So more number of electrons are going to be released, and we are going to have the high electric field to be present, and this region is going to be called as the avalanche region. And this is going to be the minimum field which is going to be required for the impact ionization process. So when this energy is going to be applied, or when this electric field is going to be present, then only the photons will make the electrons to get released from the valence band, and then it will free up the electron there, and a free electron will be generated. So this is the minimum field which is going to be required for the impact ionization process. And this region is going to be called as the depletion region. So where in this depletion region you are going to have the electric field to be a constant 1. So this we say that it is your reach through avalanche photodiode structure and the electric fields in the depletion and the multiplication regions. So we are going to create an extremely high electric field region where we are going to have approximately 3×10⁵ volts per centimeter. And here in your avalanche photodiode, we require high reverse voltages, reverse bias voltages. So the reverse bias voltages are going to be in the range from 100 to 400 volts, and for the new carriers to be created by the impact ionization process. So when you are going to do for impact ionization process, your carrier is going to be multiplied, the charge carriers are going to be multiplied, and the multiplication factor should be as great as 10⁴ and be obtained there. So under normal biasing conditions or operating conditions, the I layer, that is the P region, the P minus region is going to be completely depleted. So we call completely depleted of your charge carriers. In the normal operating conditions, it is completely depleted of charge carriers, and that condition is going to be called as the reach through condition. So hence your APDs are going to be called, avalanche photodiodes are going to be called as your reach through APDs or RAPDs there. So here the light absorption in your APDs is going to be most efficient in the I layer. In this region, in this I layer, we can see that the electric field is going to separate the charge carriers, that is the electrons, and drift into the, separate the carriers, and the electrons will drift into the avalanche region where your carrier multiplication is going to occur. So if the avalanche photodiode is going to be biased close to the breakdown region, then it will result in the reverse leakage current. So the multiplication M for all the carriers which are going to be generated in the photodiode is going to be defined as the ratio of the average value of the total multiplied output current and the IP to the IP, the primary photo current there. So M is equivalent to IP by IM, IM by IP, where IM is nothing but the average value of the total multiplied output current, and IP is going to be the primary photo current there. So here the avalanche mechanism is basically a statistical process, and in that case not every carrier pair generated in their APD is going to experience the same carrier multiplication process there. So the responsibility of the APD is going to be given as quantum efficiency into Q by H mu into M. So where your mu can be written as your lambda M. So RAPD is equivalent to, we know that V is equivalent to C by lambda. So if I substitute it, your responsibility of the avalanche photodiode is your quantum efficiency into Q lambda by HCM. So we can write it as your R0 into M, where R0 is nothing but the unity gain responsivity. Your photodetector noise. So here when your photodetector is going to detect the weak signal, it requires that the photodetector and the following amplification circuitry be optimized for a desired signal to noise ratio. That is, your photodetector should be capable of detecting a weak optical signal there. So in that case, I should see that my photodetector and the amplifier circuitry following it should be optimized for the desired signal to noise ratio there. So the equivalent circuit, if I am going to see here in this case between the photodiode and your amplifier, we are going to have a circuitry where your RS is going to be the source resistance, your CD is going to be the diode capacitance, your RL is the load resistance, and RA and CA is going to be the amplifier resistance and your capacitance there. So we have to see that it is going to be optimized for a proper signal to noise ratio. So S is nothing but the signal power from the photocurrent, and N is the noise, is nothing but the photodetector noise power plus the amplifier noise power there. So here the noise current which is going to determine the minimum optical power level that can be detected, because we should be able to generate the signal from by recovering the signal from the noise component. So that noise current is the factor which is going to determine the minimum optical power level that can be detected. The minimum detectable optical power is going to define the sensitivity of the photodetector there. So the optical power that is going to generate the photocurrent with the amplitude equal to that of the total noise current. That is, signal to noise ratio should be 1. So now we'll go for the signal calculation there. So we want to calculate what is the signal to noise ratio of the photodetector there. So a signal calculation is, we are going to consider a modulated optical power signal P of t, which is going to fall on the photodetector. With the form P of t is equivalent to P naught into 1 plus m into S of t, where S of t is nothing but the message electrical signal and m is going to be the modulation index. So here we are going to take that the modulation index m value is going to be 1. The carrier factor, the multiplication factor is going to be 1. So we can write the primary photo current is going to be quantum efficiency into q by h mu m into p of t. So here that can be written as ip of dc value, where we are going to have a dc current, plus ip of t, that is the ac current we are going to have. So the AC current can be written in terms of the root mean square signal current, where the root mean square signal current IS square is equivalent to IP square into M square. That can be written in terms of variance, that is sigma S square. IP square is equivalent to sigma P square. So sigma P square is nothing but this is your IS square is nothing but the signal current. So signal current we are going to write in terms of the AC current, that is IP square into your m square, we can write as sigma s square. So now if I am going to write your ip current, the photo current for the sinusoidal signal, then in that case we can write it as your sigma p square is equivalent to m square ip square by 2. The dc component what I am going to have is going to be written as your m square ip square by 2 there. So the noise sources in photodetectors. So the noise sources in photodetectors is, the main noise which you are going to have is your quantum noise and the dark current noise. The quantum noise or the short noise, the other name for quantum noise is short noise. So the quantum noise is going to be from the statistical nature of the production and collection of the photogenerated electrons upon the optical illumination. That is, when light is going to be illuminated, it is going to go and strike and it is going to ionize a bond and release one electron from the bond. So in that case, we are going to generate the bond and collection of these photogenerated electrons upon the optical illumination there. So it is going to follow, this statistics is going to follow a Poisson process there. So dark current noise. Dark current noise is nothing but the current that is going to continue to flow through the bias circuit in the absence of light. Name itself tells dark current. So that is, in the absence of light, whatever is going to be the current that is going to flow in the circuit is called as dark current noise. So the dark current noise is nothing but a combination of bulk dark current and surface dark current. So what is meant by bulk dark current is, the bulk dark current is going to be due to the thermally generated electrons and holes in the p-n junction there. And surface dark current is due to the surface defects, the bias voltage on the surface area, the current that is going to flow is called surface dark current. So a total photodetector noise current is equivalent to quantum noise current plus a bulk dark current noise plus surface current noise. So here quantum noise current can be written as IQ square is equivalent to sigma Q square is equivalent to 2QIP B into M square F of M, where B is nothing but the bandwidth and F of M is going to be the noise figure, and generally F of M is equivalent to M power X. So where X is going to vary from 0 greater than or equivalent to X but less than or equivalent to 1.0. Next is bulk dark current noise. So bulk dark current noise is nothing but IdB square. So IdB square is equivalent to sigma dB square, that is 2QID, that is the dark current, into bm square f of m. So for a pin photodiode, m square into f of m is equivalent to 1. So id is nothing but the bulk dark current. So surface dark current is going to be, il is the surface current there. So I can write id a square is equivalent to sigma d a square is equivalent to 2q il into b. So here just 2q il into b there. So the total RMS photodetector noise current is IN square is equivalent to summation of quantum noise plus the dark current noise. that is sigma n square is equal to iq square plus ivdb square plus ida square. So we can write it as 2q into ip plus id b into m square f of m plus 2q il b. So the thermal noise of the amplifier connected to the photo detector is going to be it square is equal to sigma t square, that is 4kb t b by RL, where RL is the input resistance of the amplifier, KB is going to be the Boltzmann constant, which is going to be joules per Kelvin there. So T is going to be the temperature. So here we want to calculate the signal to noise ratio. So signal to noise ratio is equivalent to IP square, that is your signal current IP square by into M square divided by the noise. Noise is the first one is going to be because of the quantum noise plus your dark current noise plus this is your surface current, this is your thermally generated noise. So it is 2q into ip plus id into b m square f of m plus 2q il b plus 4kb t in b by rl. So here in this case, if the noise figure f of m is going to increase with m, then there is always going to be existing an optimum value of m so that it can maximize the signal to noise ratio there. So here in this case, you should choose a proper value of m so that we can have the maximum signal to noise ratio. For sinusoidally modulated signal with m is equal to 1 and f of m is equal to m power x, we can write the optimum value of m can be x plus 2 is 2q il plus 4kb t by rl by xq into ip plus id.